Good afternoon, Cloud Community, and welcome back to Las Vegas, Nevada. We're here midway through day two of our 3 days of coverage of Google Cloud Next. My name is Savannah Peterson, here bringing you all the latest with Dave Vellante. We get to have a slightly different segment this time around.
You know, being from Boston, we're really proud of our healthcare. Maybe there's a little competition with the Mayo Clinic. I don't know.
Oh, interesting.
Yeah, I mean, you know, not me personally, but you know, in the community.
Yeah,
a little bit of FOMO when Mayo Clinic makes some breakthroughs or some great research. Yeah.
You've had all the spicy takes today, Dave. Well, we'll have to get the scoop here now that we've got Dave on the show. Thank you so much for taking the time.
Yeah, great. Happy to be here.
And Gopal, thank you for being here and curating
these
stories for us. We really appreciate you and the team. We got a doctor in the house. You're, I believe, our first doctor on stage this week. And I'm excited to hear a lot more about what you do because it's not something that we necessarily get to talk about every day. So Dave, if you wouldn't mind, give us an overview of your work and what brings you here today.
Sure. Well, I'm a behavioral neurologist, practicing clinician at Mayo Clinic in Rochester, Minnesota. Scientifically, my background's always been in quantitative neuroimaging, you know, turning images into numbers. It helps us model that data. And I direct the artificial intelligence program for the Department of Neurology at Mayo Clinic. And what we're doing is building a foundational infrastructure using clinical data flowing through cloud computing platforms and then delivering novel solutions back to practice with that clinical data.
So you're both a technologist and a doctor, really? If you're thinking about it like that, I mean, that's an incredible pairing of things. How long has that center existed? How long has the Mayo Clinic been working on AI with this level of intent?
So I can tell you, from my perspective, we started the NeuroAI program at the Department of Neurology about 6 years ago. And that was actually mainly in response with aligning with the institutional's broader mission around Bold Forward by our CEO, Gianrico Ferrugia, and partnership with Google is a part of that initiative as well. And so 6 years ago, this is what we did to try to align with that. And luckily enough, we did, and we're starting to make real progress in our practice.
I love to hear that. Gopal, y'all always bring us really exciting stories. Not surprised you're bringing us one in healthcare. Give us a little bit of the lay of the land on your role and how you identify wonderful stories like this.
That's an excellent question. So I've spent about 25 years as a business transformation consultant trying to bring the latest in technology and helping businesses transform themselves so they can be more agile, serve their stakeholders better, and obviously be profitable in doing that. In my current role, I'm responsible globally for what we do with Google's AI technology and bring them to many of our customers. And Mayo happens to be one such customer where we've had a wonderful partnership working alongside Google to support many of the initiatives at Mayo. And that's how we were introduced to the work Dr. Jones is doing. And we thought that was something the world needs to hear more of. And I will say more over the course of this discussion, but I think a lot of what you're going to hear from the work that Dr. Jones is doing is sort of staking us into the level three of the AI evolution we are on. So that's why we really have enjoyed and appreciated the opportunity to have Dr. Jones come to this session here.
We're definitely interested in hearing how you're applying AI in clinical situations, and then maybe, Gopal, what you're seeing in other, across the client base, other enterprises. Maybe, Dr. Jones, you could start.
So, you know, I'd like to maybe make it concrete for people, but what I'm trying to do is actually scale Mayo Clinic knowledge, based solidly in Mayo Clinic values, the needs of the patient come first. And we're trying to scale our approach to healthcare everywhere. Digitization of the data is a big part of that, and then you can attach Mayo Clinic knowledge to that, right? And then that'll make it widely accessible. So conditions like Alzheimer's disease or dementia, where there's about 7 million people in the United States who have that condition, but how many specialists like me are there? There's about 500 behavioral neurologists in the country, not enough. So how do we, when I look at a brain image, like an FDG PET scan of the brain, I can tell you a lot about what's going on with that patient, and that really informs my medical decision making, the diagnosis, the prognosis, the treatment, but not a lot of people can look at that scan.
You're an N of 500.
Right, even less than that, because not even that cohort has that group. So, but if you digitize that brain scan and then connect Mayo Clinic knowledge to it, you can then deliver that to anywhere where a brain scan takes place. And so that's what we've done. You know, so if you ask me about a brain scan, what I do is I say, well, I'm looking at this scan and I've seen 20 scans like that before in my life. This is what happened to that patient. This is what I did for them. And that's how people extract expert knowledge from me. We've digitized that process. So now a brain comes in and we just automatically find the matching cases. What happened to them? What's the prediction? What's the diagnosis? And that's the tool that we're starting to roll out on an investigational basis in our clinical practice, and it's really changing the way we do things.
It's got to really increase the time to your, well, the amount of time between when someone comes in and they do get that prognosis or their treatment plan.
Actually, the tool increases accuracy of reading these things by about 3 to 5 times. We think it's going to be even better.
Wow.
And
wow.
You can do it about 50% faster. So it really, and these folks,
that's
before
awesome.
They come to see us and then get a brain scan and then get the reading, that's a very long journey. But if we can take all that knowledge to the very beginning, to their brain scan, even outside of Mayo anywhere, that's a game changer.
3 to 5x relative to relative to your expertise?
To their own baseline.
Right, okay.
Yeah.
So really bringing like your level of capability, scaling that.
Exactly, so we even have residents or people in trainees, right? Oh. And it brings them up to expert level, above expert level.
Citizen neurologists.
Yeah, exactly.
No, I don't want to go there. No, just kidding.
And it doesn't make the decision for them. They understand how it's done. It's decision support. So they understand exactly how the tool is telling them about this, and they can incorporate that information, they can use that expert knowledge, and then that makes their judgment better.
Got it.
Yeah, first of all, that's incredibly impressive. When we think about expertise, particularly in healthcare, it is those big brains like yours, no pun intended, that are the things that are the least scalable, honestly, about the industry in general. This changes the ball game. I mean, this will allow you then to, I'm sure, advance research and push forward and then raise that water level up together. Little bit of pressure on you, Gopal, to make sure that you're helping implement the right technology to support these literally life-saving efforts and research and the data that's coming out of this. What's the process like for you in terms of helping Dave select the right tools for this? How do you narrow down what's going to be, I would imagine reliability, privacy, all the things are really critical, particularly in the healthcare industry.
Yeah. No, again, terrific question. And I think we bring a set of complementary skills with what he's doing. He's obviously coming up with the core of the solution in terms of what is the fundamental technology that we need in order to get to these results. But when you take that and you have to deploy it at scale in, say, any health system where it has to operate every day, process millions sometimes, certainly many in the many thousands, then you start to look at many different enterprise considerations. And that goes from what is all the wrappers that go around this in terms of do we have the right user interface for users to use. There are many, many other systems and platforms in any health system's everyday workflow. How is this getting integrated into all of those workflows? You have a whole lot of training, change management that has to happen, so every clinical staff knows how to use this, how to apply it. And that's where we can come in and support institution like Mayo to take the core technology that Dr. Jones has developed here and make it usable and scalable every day, and that's where what we do really complements what Dr. Jones is doing here.
Was there initial pushback when you started to bring in machine intelligence to augment human capability, or was it seen more as, yeah, we want to replicate Dr. Jones's
mind across the way that we designed this, the way we built the team, inside of Mayo Clinic and the Department of Neurology, It was very natural. We actually had Mayo Clinic values built into the team. And one of the core values of Mayo Clinic is multidisciplinary teams. You get people with different levels of expertise, but you're all focused on the needs of the patient. Now, in like a technology transformation, what that means is you've got domain experts like me in the healthcare question who can sit shoulder to shoulder with a data scientist who can sit shoulder to shoulder with IT expert, you know, cloud engineering expert, and the administrators. And we can talk, and we can all talk the same language, right? So people at every level of the environment that you're deploying in understand what you're doing and how you're doing it and why you're doing it. And that really helps with adoption. And then the solution actually makes sense for the environment that you're deploying in. So we did it, you know, so integrated in such a way that was familiar, Mayo values, that the adoption it really was no problem.
Are you seeing that type of receptivity across other situations in healthcare, Gopal?
In general, yes. I used the term L3 earlier in a response to an earlier question. And we are in the beginning of year three of this current AI evolution. And if I reflect on the 2 years past, I think where we've gotten to generally across the industries is L1 is now, most people have some sort of an AI co-pilot assisting them in everyday work. L2 is where you're going beyond to do better knowledge surfacing in a particular domain. And in the context of healthcare, we are seeing more of that for a clinician or clinical staff to be able to surface information in the context of the work. Where we are now starting to see more work like what Dr. Jones is doing is to get into the heart of the business. The real core of what, say, a health system delivers, or even if you take the payers, everything that they need to do with the claims processing lifecycle, these are very thorny, hairy processes that have been working the way they have. They've been glued together with many different pieces over the years. And I think now we finally have an opportunity with current available AI technology and what we can see coming in the not so distant future and completely reimagine how all of these work and in the process really improve care and obviously do things better, faster, cheaper. And that's where I think at the beginning of some of these core heart of the business processes starting to get reimagined.
I think that's so, it's got to be a really exciting time to be both of you, quite frankly. It's really interesting. What you just described, Dave, I think is an important thing to note. The fact that you can be sitting next to the data scientist and to the technologist in this moment and figure out how to solve these problems. We haven't been able to collaborate at this scale and level and speed in the past historically. What's it like being on your team right now? Are people really excited? I can imagine there's a lot of energy.
I mean, I think that is the secret sauce. I mean, when you want to do, intelligence is really about doing intelligent things in an environment, right? So if you build an intelligent solution not in that environment, it's not going to scale to that environment you're trying to do intelligent things in. This is why it's so hard to bring technology into healthcare. However, if you have a well-energized, empowered team who understands the healthcare environment deeply at every stage, the delivery, the deployment, the interpretation, the use case, all of this, small enough, you can build quickly, fail quickly in the environment, know it doesn't work in the environment. This is how you then, that's feedback. The environment, the healthcare environment is the feedback. You get these solutions which are fit to purpose. That's how you get adoption. So the small teams, everyone's very excited because we can bring these things right to the patients, right to the bedside, fail, fix, and it's. I think that's. This is the way to do it.
When the ice melts in Rochester, do you golf?
No golf.
No, you don't golf. But the Masters, I think the Masters starts today. I'm not much of a golfer either, but you know what the term mulligan. If you had a mulligan, a do-over, what would you do differently? You know, looking back, and maybe, Gopal, you could chime in with best practice, but let's start with Dave.
I just move faster. Yeah. I thought we were in the right direction. Now I'm very confident we are. If we knew that early on, we would have went faster, and we would have grown quicker and invested more. Mm.
I think reflecting on 2 years of many POCs that just fell by the wayside. One thing I would definitely encourage many enterprises to do is pick a handful of things, go deeper, don't pick 20 things and stay too broad. I think that is probably the biggest lesson.
That was an important part of what we did. You know, we didn't boil the ocean. We actually had a vision for how we could solve lots of problems, but we didn't solve them all. We selected a few that we could use to build the core infrastructure that we needed, which then other people could use after it was built.
And your criteria, your primary criteria for selection was patient, more Right?
There's a lot. Right? There's a lot. You have to, it's about alignment. It's alignment not just the future, like what's happening now, but the future, where you want to go. Uh-huh. So you always have to keep that in mind. Where are you going and how do I align my decisions now with that and the resources that are available here? So you're building things which don't exist yet. So it's a complex to select the problems. And that's you need to do that wisely.
I can imagine it's also a bit emotional. I mean, you're dealing with patient outcomes here. You've kind of got to really figure out what's going to be most effective. Building on that, what challenges are you trying to conquer next?
What challenges?
Yeah.
I mean, there's a lot.
Yeah. Well, exactly. I can imagine these conversations when you're having these vibrant discussions across your team. There's a lot you could do.
But scaling, we want to scale. We want to make sure we're building these technologies that are really helping us at Mayo Clinic. I was just at the American Academy of Neurology meeting in San Diego before I came here. A lot of interest in the technology. How do we get it? We're not at Mayo. How do we get access? So this is what I'm really focused on right now.
Do you feel like, I mean, healthcare is notoriously collaborative when it comes to sharing research results. Do you think that this will create a new level of collaboration across institutes and hospitals and clinics?
I mean, absolutely. I mean, it gives you a solid foundation to kind of understand what's happening across the country in the same framework. And so that's very powerful.
It's super powerful. Thank you for doing what you're doing. That's really exciting, honestly. It matters, let's just put it that way. I've got one final question for both of you, and I'm super curious to see what you have to say. When we're hanging out at Google Cloud next year in 2026, what do you hope to be able to say then that you can't yet say today? Gopal, I'm going to start with you.
Certainly. So we've seen many announcements this week around enabling, building out more agentic architectures. And unfortunately, the term agent has become a bit of a buzzword. Everything is called an agent. But I think if you get into the core of agentic architectures, with some of the announcements today, what it can enable is combine some of the improvements we've seen with generative AI and the ability for AI to have natural language understanding, multimodal understanding, connect it with more plain old school automation and be able to scale many of these technologies in production. So when I'm back next year, I'm hoping I'll have some real examples, more real examples of many such use cases that are now scaling at various enterprises.
Nice, we look forward to hearing those stories as well. What about you, Dave?
Next year is definitely scale. I mean, I know this helps people and I want to get it in people's hands because we want to take care of patients. We want to help people take care of patients outside of Mayo. Next year we should be saying that is happening.
Awesome. Well, we can't wait to continue covering this story. This is really fantastic. Thank you both so much for taking the time today.
Pleasure.
And for creating solutions that will impact real human lives. It's an exciting time to be alive.
Thank you.
And thank you,
thank
Dave.
You.
And thank all of you for tuning in. We're here in Las Vegas, Nevada at Google Cloud Next. My name is Savannah Peterson. You're watching theCUBE, the leading source for enterprise tech news.